فاشرف بالاشتغال بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
Then Allah says, وَجَعَلْنَا, we have made سِرَاجًا وَهَاجًا. And Allah says, we have made therein, from the samawat, Allah says, we have made a shining lamp. سِرَاجًا وَهَاجًا. We have made the samawat a shining lamp for you. Siraj here is المتقدم المضيء, something that shines for you, that you can see. We're the ones that did it. Who placed the light in it? Who's the one who takes the dark light from it later and makes it pitch black? I am the one who does that. No scientist can ever do this. No human being can do this. No leader can do this. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all of these are ni'amullah al-kawniya, the blessings that Allah has bestowed upon you, the new universal signs. He's asking you all of these questions. You need to ask yourself, who is the one who does all of this for you? And then Allah says, وَأَنزَلْنَا, we send down, وَأَنزَلْنَا مِنَ الْمُعْصِرَاتِ, we send down from الْمُعْصِرَاتِ, we send down from it, مَا and water, ثَجَّاجًا, we send ثَجَّاج from it. What does الْمُعْصِرَات mean? The Mufassirin, they have three opinions regarding what الْمُعْصِرَات means. The first opinion is the wind. The first opinion that is meant by al-mu'sirat is the wind. The second opinion is, the scholars that hold that it's, first of all, the first opinion, al-riyah, the wind, the scholars that hold that opinion is Mujahid ibn Jabr, Ikrimah, Qatada, Muqatil ibn Hayyan, and Ibn Zayd. They all believe that it's riyah, the wind. Abdullah ibn Abbas, on the other hand, and Abu Aliyah, and Dhahak, and Rabi' ibn Anas, and Sufyan, they held the opinion that it is as-sahab, it's the clouds. And the third opinion that is transmitted from Hassan al-Basri, Qatada ibn Da'amat al-Sadusi, and other than him, is that they believe al-mu'sirat means as-samawat. And all of those khilaf and differences are only differences in wordings. They are all difference in wording, and there is not a major differences. وَأَنزَلْنَا, Allah says, we have sent down مِنَ الْمُعْصِرَاتِ, from the clouds. We'll take that opinion, inshaAllah ta'ala. مَاءً وَوْتَ ثَجَّاجًا, that's large in number. Some of the Mufassirin, they said ثَجَّاجًا means the rain that comes from the clouds is a lot. But Allah doesn't make it come down as what? It doesn't pour. It sprinkles, because it will flood you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even when He sends the rain down, the rain is a sprinkle that Allah springs it upon the people. It doesn't come down like pouring bucket of water where it soaks the people. He doesn't do that, subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of this, He is the one who did it. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, he took the opinion that al-mu'sirat is as-sahab, clouds. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us the reason why He does this. And this is a refutation on those who say Allah's actions, they do not have wisdom. And everything Allah does, He just does it as He wishes, without no wisdom behind it. Everything He does, there's a wisdom behind it. لِنُخْرِجَ, the reason why we send rain and we bring it down to this earth is لِنُخْرِجَ, so that we may bring about from it. بِهِ حَبًّا وَنَبَاتًا, we want from the rain to produce grains and vegetations. Two things, habban, which is grains, wa nabatan, which is vegetations. So the rain that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down and comes to this earth, there's a wisdom behind it. There is a reason why it's coming down. It's for you to live, for you to have food to eat, for you to have crops that you can take from this earth. He is the one who is doing all of this for you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is that it? Is that it, the reason why He sends the rain? No. Is that the only reason? لا. وَجَنَّاتٍ أَلْفَافًا, and the rain that comes down, we send it down so we can make for you gardens. This garden, which is أَلْفَافًا, Abdullah ibn Abbas said أَلْفَافًا means gathered, مُجْتَمِعَ. أَلْفَافًا also means, and it's the same meaning, that the trees, from that the rain comes down, then it goes to the trees. The trees come out, and those trees have so much leaves those leaves go into each other and it become. ولذلك, that's why the garden in the Arabic language is called the what? Jannah. And the reason why it's called the Jannah is because it hides you. Those trees are what hide you. ولذلك, the womb of the mother is called what? The womb is called? Huh? Does anyone know what the womb is called in the Arabic language? No, something else, huh? Huh? What's the jinn called? I said it. Jinn, you see, it's jinn and noon, right? Jannah. Again. The gardens, all of these are from the same root word because the eyes cannot see it. Eyes can't see. You can't see the jinn. إِنَّهُ يَرَاكُمْ هُوَ وَقَبِيلُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا تَرَوْنَهُمْ. He can see you whilst you can't see it. That's why the garden is called Jannah, is because the trees are hiding it. You can't see the person who's inside it. The trees are hiding him. The jinn, you can't see him. And etc. So these are root words in the Arabic language. It means التغطية. It's something that's hidden. والتستر. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَجَنَّاتٍ. From the rains that we send down, it brings out crops, grains, it brings vegetations, it also brings trees, and those trees are so much. The greenery, you are sitting in it, you enjoy your eyes. Allah has made all of that for you. Brothers, then Allah swiftly moves on to something else. He says, Inna yawma al-fasli kana miqata. Why is Allah moving on to the Day of Judgment? And why is He talking about the Day of Judgment? There's a reason. There's a wisdom. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has just mentioned four powerful lessons for us before we move on to Inna yawma al-fasli kana miqata. What are the four lessons that we leave with? These four lessons are barahinul ba'th. Evidences that Allah is trying to bring forward that He is the one who resurrects. And He's the one who's going to bring you to the Day of Judgment. Number one, Allah used the creating of the samawat and the ard. Did He not say, أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ مِهَادًا وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادًا وَخَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا وَجَعَلْنَا نَوْمَكُمْ سُبَاتًا وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ لِبَاسًا وَجَعَلْنَا النَّهَارَ مَعَاشًا وَبَنَيْنَا فَوْقَكُمْ سَبْعًا شِدَادًا. So He spoke about الْأَرْضَ مِهَادًا, and He also said, وَبَنَيْنَا فَوْقَكُمْ سَبْعًا شِدَادًا. So He used the samawat and the ard for Him to be able to resurrect you. How? If you go to Surah Ghafir, what did Allah say? لَخَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَكْبَرُ مِنْ خَلْقِ النَّاسِ. The creating of the samawat and the ard is harder or greater than creating you. Creating you is nothing. Allah created the samawat and the ard. Would He struggle to bring you out and resurrect you again? That's the first evidence that He's trying to prove that resurrection exists, ya qawm. And you will be resurrected. The second istidlal, the second evidence that Allah is using to prove the resurrection is He gave life to this earth after it died. Did He not say, وَأَنْزَلْنَا مِنَ الْمُعْصِرَاتِ مَاءً ثَجَّاجًا لِنُخْرِجَ بِهِ حَبًّا وَنَبَاتًا وَجَنَّاتٍ أَلْفَافًا. That this earth, Allah sends rain down from the samawat to this earth, and then He brings out the crops from the earth. The same way you die, Allah gives you back life and He brings you out. That's the second. The third evidence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He does that in many places in the Quran, by the way, that second point. He said in Surah Fussilat, وَمِنْ آيَاتِ, from the signs of Allah, أَنَّكَ تَرَى الْأَرْضَ خَاشِعًا, that you see this earth is what? Is gone. فَإِذَا أَنْزَلْنَا عَلَيْهَا الْمَاءَ اهْتَزَّتْ وَرَبَتْ. We send rain down on it, and then you see the earth comes out. The crops come out. The vegetations come out. The crops, the grains, everything come out. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, إِنَّ الَّذِي أَحْيَاهَا, the one who gave it life and brought those vegetations and those grains out is لَمُحْيِي الْمَوْتَ, is the one who's going to give life back to you when he takes your life again. Number three, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using to prove that He's going to resurrect you is خَلْقُ الْإِنسَانِ. I am the one who created you in the first place. And the one who created you from nothing is easy. If He created you from nothing and made you be, then bringing you back to what you were is easier. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَخَلَقْنَاكُمْ, we created you as wajan in pairs. And we created you male and female. So if we did that, قُلْ يُحْيِيهَا الَّذِي أَنْشَأَهَا أَوَّلَ مَرَّةً وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ خَلْقٍ عَلِيمٍ. The one who created you at the first time, it is easy and it's simple for him to bring you back again. The fourth evidence that Allah already used to prove the resurrection and that he's going to bring you out is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he already brings you to life every single day, which is sleep. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَجَعَلْنَا نَوْمَكُمْ سُبَاتًا. We have made your sleep. Sleep is a small death. Do you not say every time you wake up from your sleep, do you not say, الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي أَحْيَانَا بَعْدَمَا أَمَاتَنَا وَإِلَيْهِ النُّشُورِ. So you consider your sleep as a what? Huh? It's a death. And you come back from it and you live. Those four evidences Allah has already established that he's going to resurrect you. That's why Allah is now moving on to what? And this is what's meant by أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Do you not ponder on the Qur'an or are there locks on your heart? Those four evidences were already given to you. You may not have brought it out and you may not have realized that. And these are barahinul ba'th, the evidence that Allah is pushing forward that he's the one who's going to resurrect you. Now Allah moves on to the day of judgment, because you have to believe it by now. Allah says, إِنَّ يَوْمَ الْفَصْلِ كَانَ مِيقَاتًا. The day of fas. Allah referred to it as what? يَوْمُ الْفَصْ. Why did he call it the day of fas? The fasl means that Allah distinguishes and he categorizes the people. Sahibul Jannah, the person of paradise, he's going to go to paradise. The one who's a criminal, the disbeliever, he's told go this way. The people are going to be divided. The people are not going to be together like that. Then Allah says, Kana miqata. What does the word miqat mean? Miqat, according to the mufassirin, they have three opinions. They have three opinions. The first opinion is, Inna yawm al-fasl, the day of judgment is ajal mahdood, a designated time. That's one qawl. It's a designated, restricted time for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah knows that day when it's going to come. It's a day, it's written for him. And he's placed it. The second one is, Inna yawm al-fasli, that verily the day of judgment is kana miqata ay ijtima'u al-khala'iq. The whole creation are going to be brought that day in front of him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Urat and naked, no one's wearing anything, uncircumcised, shoeless, you're not wearing nothing, you're standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third one is, Inna yawm al-fasli, verily the day of judgment, kana miqat. Miqat means it's a day Allah promises that he's going to reward the people who deserve to be rewarded, and the ones who deserve to be punished are going to be punished. That's what's meant by the word miqat according to the mufassirin. Allah says that subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, يَوْمَ يُنْفَقُ فِي الصُّورِ فَتَأْتُونَ أَفْوَاجًا. The day when the trumpet is blown into, فَتَأْتُونَ, you will come forward, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, you will come forth, أَفْوَاجًا, you will come in groups and in crowds, in number, together, you're going to come forward, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. The mufassirin, the scholars of tafsir, they differ on what is meant by يَوْمَ يُنْفَقُ فِي الصُّورِ. Sur, what is meant by it? There are two opinions. Some scholars, they said يَوْمَ يُنْفَقُ فِي الصُّورِ, what's going to be blown into is the trumpet. That's one qawl. The second qawl and the second opinion according to the mufassirin is what is going to be blown into is the people. Allah is going, the soul is going to be blown into the people. And those are two opinions. The first one is the qarn, when Israfil, he places when Israfil blows into the trumpet the second time. The first time, when he blows into it, those who are alive will die. And then he blows into it again. ثُمَّ نُفِقَ فِيهِ أُخْرَى فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. And then the second time he blows into it, the people are going to be resurrected and they're going to come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the angel that is going to be blowing into it is who? Israfil. And wallahi, brothers, pondering this verse alone gives you a lot of lessons. Look what Allah says. Yawma, the day, yunfahu. Ponder on the word yunfahu that's being used here. Yunfahu in the Arabic language is called al-maf'ulu alladhi lam yusamma fa'ilu. The one who is blowing in the trumpet has not been mentioned here. And the reason why Allah did that is so you don't become distracted with other information, so you seriously just focus on the event and what is being spoken about, and side informations don't take you. Imagine if a person is reading the Quran and they are being distracted with other things, and they are not pondering and they are not thinking. Allah doesn't even mention, He doesn't mention two things. Number one, who is blowing into the trumpet? Israfil. He conceals that information, because what's important now is the event. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He also doesn't mention the amount of stages that the people will go through the Day of Judgment. It's not one stage, it's stages. But Allah chose to hide it. The Mufassirin, they said the reason why Allah hid, why He hid it, is because it's all going to look like kalamhil basar. All of the stages are going to look like they went fast when it comes to the accounting of the creation, the Day of Judgment. And the people are brought to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now here's an ishkal, or an issue that comes forward, brothers. Here Allah is telling us that the people are going to come in crowds. But in another ayah, in Surah Maryam, ayah 95, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَكُلُّهُمْ آتِيهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَرْدًا. And the people are going to come to Allah that day alone. So how do we reconcile between those two verses? It's easy to reconcile between it. What we say is, and what is apparent is, the people's coming in crowds is as soon as the trumpet is blown. As soon as the trumpet is blown, the people are going to come in crowds, and they're going to come in numbers up from their graves, because everybody's going to come out their graves, and the numbers are, everyone's going to walk towards the Ardul Mahshar. And the Ardul Mahshar is going to be Sham, Dimashq. Sham is the place of Mahshar. So the people are going to make their way there. So what's going to happen? The people are going to come in large numbers. They're going to come in large numbers. And when the people are coming to Allah alone, and one after the other, is when they're being asked questions. You come. And they're being accounted. They're going to come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And that's how you reconcile between the two verses. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَفُتِحَتِ السَّمَاءُ فَكَانَتْ أَبْوَابًا. There's two qira'ah, two ways of reciting this verse. You can do tashdeed of the ta and say وَفُتِحَتْ. And if you say وَفُتِحَتْ and you place shadda on the ta and you take that recitation, فِيهِ مُبَالَغَةً. There's emphasis on it. There's an emphasis on it, which is the way that the samawat will be open. We just took right now that the samawat is, there's no crack and there is nothing. But that day, the Day of Judgment, the sama is going to be cracked open. It's going to be cracked. وَفُتِحَتِ السَّمَاء. The sama is going to be cracked open. فَكَانَتْ أَبْوَابًا. And so then they're going to be made gates on the samawat. Gates and doors. Angels are going to come down from it. This is the day of hisab, reckoning and accountability of the creation. So the way that it's going to be open, based on the qira'ah that says وَفُتِحَتْ, it means that al-mubalagha, that the opening is not going to be small. It's actually going to be a very large amount that the samawat is going to be open. And again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He uses al-maf'ulu alladhi lam yusamma fa'ilu wafuti wafutihat. Allah uses wafutihat, meaning the one who's opening it is not being mentioned here. The reason why it's not mentioned is so you don't focus on who's opening it. Rather, you focus on the event that's taking place. This sama, ya ikhwa, that day is going to open. It's going to be cracked open. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the people will see that. That the one who looks will see a crack in the sama. And then Allah says, وَسُيِّرَتِ الْجِبَالُ فَكَانَتْ سَرَابًا. And the mountains shall be moved away from their places. The sama, the mountains that were pegged on this earth that I just mentioned to you recently, that Allah previously just mentioned, the mountains that were pegged on the earth, that were holding the earth, are no longer on the earth anymore. They've been ripped off the roots and they've been taken off the ground. وَسُيِّرَتِ الْجِبَالُ. The mountains are going to be taken off its off the ground. فَكَانَتْ, and it will become like سَرَابًا. سَرَابًا means like a mirage. Mirage. It looks like the mountain is no longer on the earth. It's like a mirage. You know what a mirage is, right? It's when you see a water in front of you and you keep driving to it to get to it, but there's nothing there. The mountains become like that. The mountains are destroyed. And Al-Allama Siddiq Hasan Khan Al-Qannuji Rahimahullah, he tried to make levels of how the mountain goes through, because there's many different stages it goes through. He tries to give an order to it in his tafsir, Fathul Bayan, in his tafsir. But this order really doesn't have no evidence. So we're not going to mention it. The mountain is going to be taken from its roots and is going to be ripped off. Ya ikhwa ponder wallahi. Isn't that a day for you to prepare? And for a day for you to think, what have I put forward? Allah says, Inna Jahannama, verily Jahannam, kanat Jahannama is mirsadan. The word mirsadan is three opinions. One is tataraqabu ahliha, that Jahannam is a place of ambush. It's a place of ambush. Means Jahannam is observing the people, and any one of its people that goes by it, it grabs it and it destroys it. It's an ambush. That's one. The second opinion that some of the Mufassirin took is that Jahannam is waiting in high need. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, Jahannam has 70,000 ropes. 70,000 ropes that are dangling from it. لِكُلِّ زِمَام. Each rope, 70,000 malakin yajurunaha. 70,000 angels holding down Jahannam, telling Jahannam, stay down, don't move. Jahannam is roaring. إِذَا رَأَتْهُم مِّن مَكَانٍ بَعِيدٍ سَمِعُوا لَهَا تَغَيُّضًا وَزَفِيرًا. Jahannam is roaring, it's making a loud noise. What? Because it can see its people that it needs to take in, walking right in front of it. This is the state of Jahannam that day. Allah says, Inna Jahannama, verily Jahannam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, here He used the word Inna, which it shows ta'keed and emphasis. Verily, Inna Jahannama, Jahannam, kanat, it is mirsadam. And the third one is, the third opinion is that even the believers are going to go over Jahannam. And this is in accordance to the ayah, وَإِن مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا وَارِدُهَا كَانَ عَلَىٰ رَبِّكَ حَتْمًا مَقْضِيًا ثُمَّ نُنَجِّي الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا وَنَظَرُ الظَّالِمِينَ فِيهَا جِثِيًا. That وَإِن مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا وَارِدُهَا أي وَارِدُهَا فِي جَهَنَّمْ. Every one of you is going to go over Jahannam. The sirat is above Jahannam. And the Prophet told us it has kalalib. It has metal rods on the side. So all of these three meanings, they all enter one meaning, which is, and they don't, there's no differences. If we take that this is the sirat and that everybody's going to go over it and it has metal rods and it will grab onto the people, and every single person that day will go over the sirat based on the action and the efforts that they put forward. Allah says, ثُمَّ نُنَجِّ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا. The only people who are going to be saved that day, who are going to make it through, are those who are pious, who are righteous, who are noble. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes us from those people. Allah tells us who are the people who are going to stay in Jahannam, who are going to be the dwellers of Jahannam. May Allah protect us from it. لِلطَّاغِينَ مَآبًا, a dwelling place for the disbelievers. Jahannam is a dwelling place for the disbelievers. Why is it? Because they disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They went against His command. They disobeyed Him. They transgressed. They exceeded their limits that were set for them. And the believers are also going to be in the hellfire if they disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one needs to worry and be concerned. لِلطَّاغِينَ مَآبًا, a dwelling place for the disbelievers. Allah then says, لَابِثِينَ فِيهَا, they will remain in it. لَابِثِينَ فِيهَا, they will remain in it. أَحْقَابًا. The word ahqab is jam'u hukub. Here's a discussion that needs to have. The word hukub in the Arabic language is 18 years. Some said 300 and something years. Some of the a'immatu salaf, they restricted. It's a muddatun zamaniya that has a time. So Allah is saying, لِلطَّاغِينَ مَآبًا, the people who are going to reside in the hellfire are the disbelievers. Then Allah says, لَابِثِينَ, they will stay in there, أحقاباً, a duration of time. So is it right for a person to say that the hellfire will never be there forever? And that the hellfire will stay for a short period of time and then it will not? Huh? If أحقاباً is this case? The Mufassirin, they responded to this. They gave three answers. The first opinion is the opinion held by Hassan al-Basri, Qatadat ibn Da'amat al-Sudusi, al-Rabi' ibn Anas. They said, it's like when you say this person is going to stay there for years. It means they're going to be there forever. He's been given time. Huh? In prison, huh? He's been given time. Or he ain't coming out anytime soon. That does not mean you restricted it to a particular time. It can even be lifetime. Sah. This means لَابِثِينَ فِي أَحْقَابَ, that they will stay in there for years. This years, Allah did not restrict it. So it means that they're going to be there forever. That's one view. But the strongest one and the one I like is the view taken by Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. And he's got ayats to prove him, which is the context itself. And what Allah says here makes sense. لَابِثِينَ فِيهَ أَحْقَابًا means that they stay in the hellfire for a time. Na'am. Based on a particular punishment. One punishment is going to be for a couple of years, and then that punishment is going to be changed to another punishment, and then another punishment. And each punishment is for a couple of years. But they're never going to leave punishment. The reason is because the siyaq and the context restricts that. Where Allah says, لَا يَذُوقُونَ فِيهَا بَرْدًا وَلَا شَرَابًا إِلَّا حَمِيمٌ وَغَسَّاقًا. The punishment, when they get destroyed by this type of punishment, then they're going to be moved to another type of punishment, and then to another punishment, and then another punishment. And each punishment has a duration. That's what Ibn Jarir al-Tabari rahimahullah took. The third opinion is the qawl taken Maqatil ibn Hayyan, which he said that this ayah is abrogated. He said it's abrogated. And this is incorrect. To say that's abrogated. That if we take that the abrogation that the Maqatil ibn Hayyan used is based on the mansukh used by the Mutaakhirin. Because the Mutaqaddimin, the early generation, when they used mansukh, they didn't mean what we understand it as. They meant what? Takhsis, specification. Takhsis for them was mansukh, and it was a synonym. Like, and if we take that Maqatil means here that it's abrogated, then what we know is that you can't abrogate statements. You can only abrogate rulings. Akhbar la yunsakh. A khabar, you can't come to somebody and say, I was in Umrah, I did Hajj last year, and they say, I abrogated it. News are not abrogated. What's abrogated is rulings. When you're commanded to do something or told to stay away from something. That's what's abrogated. But news are not abrogated. If a person says, oh, I didn't go Hajj last year, I abrogated that, he's lying. Sah. So the second opinion seems strongest. لَابِثِينَ فِيهَا, they will stay in there. أَحْقَابًا. And we're going to conclude there, inshaAllah ta'ala, it's 9 o'clock. سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ بِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ.